Ringa pakkia! Vai vai takahia!
Fuchsia excanticata, the only real tree fuchsia, is living here in New Zealand, and it's strange because so many New Zealand plants, which are shrubby or herbaceous in other countries of the world, for instance fuchsias in South America, are usually small shrubs. Here it becomes a big tree. And when we see the rubus also, for instance, the rubus in Europe, in Asia, are usually very small scrambling plants, weak climbers, but here they are very strong climbers with stems up to 5-8 centimeters in diameter. So here in New Zealand, the plants like to be very ligneous, very woody. Pseudowinterra colorata, a very primitive member of the Winterraceae family, which is mostly southern hemisphere, in southern hemisphere, in southern part of South America and New Zealand, Australia. Very typical with the dark purple blotches on the leaves. Underside of the leaf is also whitish with purple markings or pinkish.
It is the same species, but different color.
Yes, the pink, I don't know what it is. The pink form, brownish pink leaves, and the green form, both have almost black stems, but leaves are totally different. For me, it's very surprising because usually I see these two forms of foliage, green and brown, in the forest understory, especially in tropical rainforest understories. But here, actually, we are in an alpine zone in New Zealand, so it's totally not the same. It's totally in full sun, and also here we have both forms of color growing together exactly in the same environment. When people try to explain that one form is more adapted to the sun and one other to the shade, it's totally stupid because, as we can see, of course, it's growing in exactly the same habitat. And it's really a patchwork of brown, green, brown, green, green, brown, green. So, absolutely in the same habitat. We are here in the Mount Cook National Park, almost in the center of the South Island of New Zealand, so in a temperate latitude, about 45 degrees south. And we see it's very strange because elevation is not high. We are about 800, 850 meter elevation, but we have already alpine vegetation. And we see that the ice on snow is almost at the same altitude, I mean about 1,000 meters. If we imagine the same in Europe or North America, of course in Europe, for instance, in the Alps, you have snow in July, because now it's early January, the same as early July in Europe. The snow should be, or the snow line should be around, only around almost 2,000 meters elevation. So here it's typical of these South Island, South Hemisphere islands. Winter is not very cold, usually not less than -8, -10, but summer are not very hot. It's why also we have snow in so low altitude. So this alpine vegetation, of course, we see the Acephila, for instance, is the Umbelliferae. Here, flowers are finished, but so it's very interesting because the leaves look absolutely like yucca leaves. But when we have a look, a more closer look, we see that actually it's a pinnate leaf with about five diverging pinnae on the leaf. So actually the leaf looks superficially like monocotyledon, but in detail we see it's not a monocot. We see here, oh, hebe, of course, many species of hebe are here. I see the tiny also Podocarpus nivalis, many Coprosma in a Rubiaceae. There are, I don't remember, but maybe about 50 species of Coprosma. Some are trees in the understory of the forest, but most of them are small shrubs or carpeting shrubs. We see also, of course, the Dracophyllum, like here, this species of Dracophyllum, which is quite common. Dracophyllum is very interesting because we can see big, big plants in the understory of the forest, especially in the North Island at the north, like in Waipua, and they look like a huge Dracaena. And here, in open areas, we have much smaller species with erect leaves. We see the Coriaria here. Everywhere are two Coriaria species, one which has red stems, like these individuals, and another one which very tiny, tiny leaves, and which looks exactly like an asparagus. So, of course, so there are also grasses. Here, we see Gaultheria in Ericaceae, more traditional Ericaceae. Here, is here is oh yes, it's another Dracophyllum species, but actually I did not yet see it because it's it has very tight tightly pressed leaves, and it's quite different from the other one. And this one seems to be not so common as the other one. Hebes also are mostly diversified in these areas with about, I think, about 40 species, and Coriaria is very rich. Acephila also many species, same as Selmisia in the daisy family, there are many species. So it means that this environment is quite new in New Zealand and appears from nowhere else in the world, and some species did evolve very quickly in this totally open and free environment. Also, we can see some very strange shrubs, for instance, in the daisy family, but I don't know, it's not an Olearia. I have to check to know which species it is, but it's very spectacular because it's only about 2 meters high, but the canopy is totally a canopy with crown shyness, crownlet shyness, exactly the same as you can see in big trees in the forest canopy, like for instance a big eucalypt, which can reach 60 or 80 meters high. But here we have exactly the same structure with necrosis and with bifurcation of branches on a shrub which is only 2 meters high. So it's very exciting to see that this structure, this growth habit of mature tree crowns can also happen in very small shrubs. But this shrub, when we see the size of the stems at the base, probably is very old, probably some tens of years old. So it's very diverse according to the place where we are looking at the plants. But now we'll try to go a little bit lower to look at the divaricate shrubs, because of course New Zealand is a totally divaricate country. We see now a huge specimen of Notophagus menziesi, one of the southern beeches, not actually really closely related to beeches. But actually I see something very new for me. I mean, the crownlets in most of the trees in the canopy, we know crownlets, but usually crownlets are, we can see in trees which have leaves usually 4 to 7 or 8 centimeters long, and one crownlet is usually about 1 meter in diameter. Here in this Notophagus, we see the big crownlets which are about 1 meter in diameter, but inside these crownlets we see tiny crownlets. And it's the first time I see this. And these tiny crownlets are only about 15, maybe between 10 and 20 centimeters in diameter. Why? It's because the leaves of this Notophagus menziesi are so tiny. They are usually less than 1 centimeter long, usually 8 to 12 millimeters. So we have tiny crownlets, micro crownlets, which are about 15 centimeters long. So we see that this adjustment of the size of the crownlet is depending on the size of the leaves. And this is the first time I see so tiny crownlets in a tree. Coriaria, one of the many Coriaria species here. We love it. But actually, what is most interesting now is that I did make a big mistake before, because this leaf, totally peltate, with the petiole coming in the middle of the leaf, and totally round, with teeth, hydrated teeth, white teeth at the periphery, with very prominent nerves. I was thinking, of course, seeing the inflorescence, it was an umbelliferae, something like a giant hydrocotyle. But actually, looking at the books, I suddenly discovered that actually it was not at all an umbelliferae, but a ranunculus, a buttercup. A giant buttercup endemic from this mount here, Mount Cook. And it's a ranunculus loyally, and we see the inflorescences and some remaining petals around and the structure, but I'm very surprised to see such big structure, apical structure, with all, of course, the ovaries and pistils in this flower, ranunculus flower. Petals were just around here, some are remaining here. We see one of the late white petals and all the ovaries at the top of the flower. So it's incredible to see such a huge ranunculus. New Zealand is decidedly a very special country. Well, woo! Here we are facing the mystery of the divaricating habit of New Zealand plants. Divaricating, what does it mean? This plant, for instance, this shrub, I think it's actually a corokia in the Ramnaceae due to the shape of the leaf. Anyway, any species you can consider, it's always the same thing. Divaricating habit is mostly the most evident fact to see is the zigzagging habit of the stems. Anyway, what is divaricating? Many different things. Almost always very small leaves. Small leaves, usually less than 1 centimeter long. Very long internodes. I mean, between each leaf, there is a length which is 5 to 10 times longer than the leaf itself. It means also branching, ramification at almost each leaf. Here we see one leaf, one branch, one leaf, one branch, one leaf, one branch. Always like this. So we have this zigzagging pattern. Why is it this zigzagging? Because, of course, we see the stems because the leaves are so small, and zigzagging because there is always a very sharp angle, not sharp, a very wide angle at each ramification, almost 90 degrees. We see, for instance, here and here, it's almost 90 degrees between the main stem and the lateral stem. And still another, this I think is a Coprosma in the Rubiaceae, another divaricating shrub. Yes, it's a Coprosma with opposite twigs. So we see what is so strange about this phenomenon is that divaricating habit concerns so many different and absolutely unrelated families. So, because we can find even in conifers, for instance, the Prumnopitis taxifolia as a juvenile stage, which is divaricate. It concerns many families. Here we see a Cornaceae, this, maybe a Malvaceae, this is a Rubiaceae. It's also Polygonaceae with the Muhlenbeckia, even the Sophora. Sophora microphylla, which is growing almost everywhere at the young stage, which is divaricate. In Pittosporum, of course, we find also divaricating shrubs because more than 50, about 60 species are concerned in many different families. So interpretation is not so easy. Of course, the easiest interpretation is that before human beings are coming in New Zealand, there was a giant moa birds, a ratite birds, which were up to about 3 meters high, and they were browsing. And it was considered to be an adaptation to avoid browsing by the moa birds. But in all other parts of the world, it's not birds, it's mammals which are doing this. Of course, this is a good way to avoid to be browsed. This is a good way in a so windy country also to resist to the wind, because the wind can go through the plant and not damage it. But it seems much more probable that actually these mutations which did arrive in so many unrelated families probably are something which is now commonly practiced by human beings. The transgenic way to have new characters in plants. So probably here in New Zealand, either viruses or fungi or bacteria did probably take some parts of genes which are responsible for this divaricating habit. So now, of course, before maybe 30 or 40 years ago, it was quite not serious to think about that. But now that we know that it's so easy, quite easy, to transfer genes from one, from totally unrelated plants or animal to other ones, so it seems actually it's something much more general, which should affect mostly dicotyledons, of course, but also some conifers and, in some way, some ferns. Monocots seem not to be concerned by this. But anyway, it's one of the big, big mysteries and fascinating mysteries of New Zealand. So, will go on in this Notophagus beech forest.
Oh madame, Agarita, l'avenir,
the beautiful white flowers of Leptospermum scoparium. Many pink varieties have been selected from this regenerating tree, and but the usual color is white. And there is also a small Kuntzea, also in the Myrtaceae family, but Kuntzea has smaller flower, and the Leptospermum has these bigger white, pure white flowers. When we think about the genus Coprosmia, the Rubiaceae, the coffee family, we always think about the small shrubs in open habitats. But many are forest trees, like this one, which is in fruit. And we recognize Rubiaceae because opposite leaves, no indentation, and stipular area here. And also what is very characteristic of Coprosmia, different species, is a domacia, a kind of small glands at the junction of the lateral nerves with the main nerve. Actually, it's a kind of small pouchy, small pocket, inhabited usually by tiny spider, tiny arachnids. And also, some are actually simply domacia with simply the cells which are very rich in chlorophyll, and they are acting like glands. So in some cases it's pouchy, in some cases it's really glands. And here in this case, for this species, it's glandular structure. Ah, two Hebe species growing together. Actually, Hebe, the genus, seems to be no longer recognized, and now it has been merged in the huge genus Veronica. But it's a little bit a pity because it was so easy to recognize a Hebe from New Zealand. Side by side, we have the juvenile and adult phase of a Pseudopanax crassifolius, the lancewood. So we see the green adult wide leaves and, of course, the very narrow, very long brown leaves with a pink midrib.
many seedlings of the Notophagus beeches, the huge trees, but seeds are very small and germination occur mostly among mosses covering dead trunks or dead branches or stones. Here, a little bit bigger, and very young seedlings everywhere, here, here, here. So, one more time. Mosses provide very good germination substrate, especially for plants with tiny seeds, and not only small understory plants, but also huge trees like this Notophagus.
We are now in the Fiordlands, in the extreme south of the South Island of New Zealand, about 45 degrees of latitude, exactly 45 degrees of latitude, so it's totally temperate. But as it's so close to the sea, to the ocean, it is on the west side of the South Island, so it means that the winds coming from the sea bring a lot of water. Today is quite okay, but it's a very humid forest. This forest is totally dominated by one species of southern beech. It is Notophagus fusca. Also, there are also Notophagus menziesii. For instance, here is menziesii with very small leaves, and here with bigger leaves is Notophagus fusca, the red southern beech. What is very impressive is all the mosses covering totally the trunks, and many, many different species, and also there are many lichens also covering branches. So this is typical of the very high level of humidity. Also, in spite of the cold weather, we have many epiphytic plants, some orchids, but mostly this wonderful Asplenium flaccidum, a fern hanging from many, many branches. We have to be careful because with the mosses, it is somewhat, of course, unstable. And why? Actually, why mosses are everywhere, even on the soil? It's because these southern beech have very small leaves. So it means that the leaves are taken inside the mosses, so it's not at all a problem to, for the mosses to cover the soil. So with this so humid weather, mosses are growing everywhere. Of course, along vertical trunks, but also, of course, on dead logs, dead branches, and actually on the soil. We never know what is the soil, what is mosses, what is dead logs, because mosses are carpeting everywhere. And why mosses can also grow horizontally is because the southern beeches, the nothofagus, have very small leaves. So in the forest, each time you have trees with small leaves, these small leaves are very easily covered by the growing mosses. Of course, if we have big leaves like this, only 5 or 10 centimeters, you have a litter of dead leaves and it's impossible for the mosses to grow through the dead leaves. But in the case of the nothofagus with so small leaves, it's not a problem for mosses, and it's why these New Zealand forests are often covered by mosses. It's because it's forests with very small leaved trees. So it's very exceptional actually and very characteristic of New Zealand. There are many dead trees, fallen dead trees. Probably many years ago it was a very, very strong storm and many trees seem to have collapsed and fallen. But mosses are covering, and of course the tiny seeds of the nothofagus can germinate on all these fallen trees. It's a very good nursery logs for the nothofagus. So the dead ones are nursery logs for the new young ones. So many moss species. We see the baby nothofagus germinating among all the mosses. All these are baby nothofagus fusca growing in the thick layer of mosses due to their very small seeds.
Yes, in this forest, very humid and quite high altitude, very close to Milford Sound in the south and west part of New Zealand. Here, it's incredible. Together, we can find five different species of Araliaceae, of Pseudopanax. This one with thick, three-lobed leaves is probably Pseudopanax lessonii. Another one here with very dentate leaves with five leaflets. I don't know which one it is. Maybe it is a juvenile of this one. And here, a very dentate form of Pseudopanax crassifolius. And finally, this one, which is Pseudopanax, I think, longifolius, which has very narrow leaves. All this along the roadside. So even along the roadside, the forests are very well protected. So this one is common in these quite cold places. And I'm very surprised by the so strong indentation of this Pseudopanax crassifolius. In this place, only 1 meter, I can embrace with my arms, four species or five species of Pseudopanax growing together along the road approaching Milford Sound. This is probably the smallest plant in the iris family. It's a Libertia pulchella. It is now in fruit. It has just a fan of very narrow leaves growing always close to waterfalls. And here we have seen the so incredible chasm place where the water is engulfing and where there are also iridescent mosses on the, along the stones. And here, so we find this, this species is shared with Australia, also close to waterfalls. I have seen in the Blue Mountains, for instance, but it's not common. Three carpels, and we see the three-lobed fruit. A tiny plant, leaves like Acorus in a fan.
Janvier, Queenstown, the last day in New Zealand.
Oh madame, oh madame, oh Garita, l'avenir. L'avenir, l'avenir, ce n'est pas encore tout ça pour finir. Et notre âme, est-elle immortelle ou pas, cher plaisir? Rimer âme, iréar, feindre ou peindre, cindre, geindre et gémir. Dans les cartes, lait marnisé, notre sang et nos souvenirs. Oh madame, oh madame Margarita, l'avenir, 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 ce n'est pas encore tout ça pour finir. Et notre âme est-elle immortelle ou pas, cher plaisir? Mais notre âme, à notre âme, immortelle ou pas, est-elle pour finir?